The history of childhood is an interesting topic because for a long time, of course, it didn't really exist. Like many other topics that were only discovered or invented in the 20th century or after World War II, children and childhood was something that traditional historians had simply never considered. One of the reasons that it became of interest was the rise of the idea of childhood as a construct. That is, the childhood was not something that was immutable and had always been just this way, but rather was something that was socially constructed. Children, of course, have been a part of history as long as there have been humans who have been living on this earth and recording their history. But the traditional view for a long, long time is that children were essentially little adults. And the most famous proponent of this theory was a French historian named Philippe Ariès. And he wrote a very famous and also very controversial book, Centuries of Childhood. His view was that the crucial point in the construction or the creation or the invention of childhood is something that happened especially in the 18th and the early 19th century. And then really since about 1985 or 1990, the vast majority of scholarship has come out against Ariès. Ariès tapped into a common belief about the Middle Ages, which is that it was a foreign land. If the Middle Ages, generally speaking, are different, then they must have been different in terms of children too. And so they must not have loved their children, and they must not have taken good care of them. This question of love and grief as it regards children in the Middle Ages or in early modern Europe really goes, I think, to the crux of the argument here. The traditional argument being that people in the Middle Ages and early modern Europe had all of these children, and it was a sort of self-defense mechanism to not invest as much in their children because they knew that probably half of their children were going to die before they came to adolescence or adulthood. And there certainly is some evidence for that. If we look at naming practices, for example, often when one child would die and the next one was born, the subsequent child would be given the same name as the previous one. On the other hand, a number of sources have become available to us in recent years that suggest the deep emotional anguish that parents suffered at the death of their children. I teach a course on the history of childhood at UMass Lowell. The students in the class are very surprised when they come to find that there's this whole burgeoning field of scholarship. For them, childhood is simply a reality that's based on their own experience or the experience of their friends, but they've not often thought about what would it have been like to have been a child 500 years ago or 700 years ago. And if they do think about that, then they tend to reflect Ariès's position that there wasn't really much of a concept of childhood back then. So I reread many of these primary sources about what it was to be an infant. One of the immediate differences that I noticed had to do with swaddling, that is wrapping up a child very, very tightly when they're a newborn. This was something that when I taught the class the first time, my students had been simply horrified by. And indeed, many of the primary sources that we read suggested that this was a barbaric way to treat children and that children should be free and independent and able to exercise their limb. There, I remember there was one image in particular that we looked at where a child was all swaddled and then they were swaddled to a backboard and then the backboard was hung on a hook on the wall. And my students were really struck by this, and I was too, and we all sort of dismissed swaddling as one example of a lack of parental love. Then I had my own child, and we discovered that she loved being swaddled and that it made her feel much more secure, and she cried much less and she smiled more. That one example of swaddling, certainly my opinion on that changed as a result of having my own child. Using images is one of the most effective ways to try to convey to students and to the general public what the image of childhood, what the perception, what the construction of childhood was in previous eras. And we can learn a lot about birthing practices and care of newborns and attitudes as expressed towards children by looking at these kinds of images. Like this one, for example, which is a late medieval Italian painting, a miniature, and it shows that an Italian cradle is rocked from head to foot, whereas in Northern Europe, it's much more common for the cradle to be rocked from left to right, that is, from side to side. We also learn a lot from these kinds of images about childhood accidents. This is another image with showing the baby Jesus with a toy windmill. And again, this, I think, emphasizes the playful nature of childhood. Probably the best image of childhood is the one by Peter Bruegel. Peter Bruegel was a Northern European painter in the late 16th century, and he included something like 200 figures in this painting, most of whom were children, most of whom were engaged in various kinds of games and activities. And so they are, and some of these are still games that we play today. So they're rolling hoops, they're playing hide and seek, they're dunking each other in a pond, they're riding a hobby horse. In the case of the Bruegel image, I think it is true that it's often hard to distinguish the age of particular children, or even to tell whether somebody is a child or an adult. I think it is also true that children in the Middle Ages and early modern Europe wore clothing that was more similar to grown-ups, to adult clothing. Children simply wore smaller or shorter or cut-off versions of the kinds of clothing that grown-ups wore. It seems to me that childhood has always been with us, and that I take exception to Arias's point. I disagree with him when he claims that there was no concept of childhood, or that the concept of childhood became radically distorted and changed or invented in the 18th century. It seems to me that there's an overwhelming amount of evidence about how parents did love their children. It's probably the most famous is the concept of the seven ages of man, illustrating that man progresses through seven verifiable and distinct ages, ranging from infancy and toddlerhood, the young man, the full-grown adult, and the senex, the old man. The question of modern childhood and where are we in the early 21st century, I think the image of childhood is always changing. The ever-increasing flow of information robbed children of some of the innocence or the protective cocoon that childhood for the past couple of hundred years has come to define. And so children are increasingly bombarded with commercial messages and advertising, that fashion for children has increasingly come to resemble that of teenagers or adults, robbing the innocence of childhood, of taking away that protective shield that has for so long separated children and made them different than teenagers and different than adults, that in some ways that does seem to be disappearing. When I first proposed this course on the history of childhood in medieval and Renaissance Europe, there was not another course on that topic anywhere in the United States. And so my hope is that there will be more courses like that in the future.